500 years ago, there were people on both sides of the Atlantic Ocean, but neither knew about the other. On the western side, our side, the people had reddish-brown skins and lived in huts or wigwams. On the eastern side, in Europe, the people were white-skinned. They had learned how to build houses and large sailing ships, but they still didn't know much about the rest of the world.
Everybody thinks of 1492 as some magic date in which Columbus discovered, quote, America. But Columbus was in the Caribbean, and he never at any time came to the United States.
No, he never was near the continental mass of America. The great navigator that he was, you know, who washed up on a beach in the Caribbean, half a world away from where he thought he was, gets known as the great navigator. The navigator could never find his way from the island to the mainland. He couldn't discover the continent.
Oh, I think it is rather surprising that they should have reddish-brown skins. But now since we have landed in India, then these people must be Indians.
It's very interesting that Columbus's first comments regarding the Native American or the indigenous people was that they were very loving, giving. They would trade or give anything that they had. They were without malice, without guile. The whole concept that Columbus thought these were savage people was totally incorrect.
This part of India, San Salvador, and I take possession of it in the name of the King and Queen of Spain.
It's hard to discover an occupied territory. I often go for the first time to visit people who have moved into the area. It may be the first time I've been to their living room, but I can hardly say I discovered it. I mean, after all, they lived there. Much less can I extrapolate by virtue of my noble achievement of knocking on their door that somehow or another the newly discovered living room becomes mine.
The general consensus is that Spain came for God, glory, and gold, and God being that they were going to spread the Catholic religion, glory because they were going to add more land to the crown, and of course gold because they were going to get rich.
Columbus had no trouble getting ships and men for his second voyage, but he still hadn't the slightest idea that he was headed for the vast continent of America.
They issued documents to the native people to be read to the native people, saying, "If you don't convert to Catholicism and give us the gold, we will do all types of harm to you. We will kill your families. We will take your land. We will enslave you." And when native people didn't tell them where the gold was, or in many cases didn't know where the gold was, the Spanish simply tortured these people. They burned them at the stake alive. They had large hunting dogs that they fed the Indians to. It was death and destruction.
Bartolomé de las Casas, who was there during Columbus's tenure as governor of the island, placed the beginning population at about 3 million. 20th century historical demographic studies had placed it as high as 8.5 million. Whatever the reality actually was, it had been reduced to about 100,000 by the time he left, and by 1550, it was gone. Extinct. Columbus is symbolic, but what Columbus symbolizes is hideous. Columbus being valorized in the mythology of the United States is roughly the same as Germany valorizing Heinrich Himmler now. And in teaching this to Jewish students, as well as German students, and conditioning them to accept it.
But each year on October 12th, we celebrate Columbus Day. The anniversary of that day in 1492, when Columbus first sighted the land of the New World, America.
The U.S. is in a, you know, it's a strange society because I think consciously the country wants to believe that it does good and that it has, you know, good intentions around the world. And it's not very in touch with its subconscious self that's a lot meaner and a lot more homicidal than the self that it would like to acknowledge.
Do you think that genocide is too strong a word to what's happened?
Absolutely not. At times it did fit all the definitions of genocide.
The United Nations Political Committee debates an issue as vital as any in its history.
Article 2 of the Convention reads pretty much as follows. Genocide shall be understood as any policy undertaken with intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group as such. The first is killing members of the group.
At various times in this country's history, there have been policies that would equate to genocide because they say kill them all. They make no provisions for taking of prisoners, and they use words like exterminate and decimate. In some of these warfare, they say kill them all, nits make lice. That means kill the children because they'll grow up to be Indian.
Territory of Colorado became a state by virtue of proclaiming an extermination policy against the Cheyennes and Arapahoes and actualizing that in the Sand Creek Massacre of November 1864. Very proud moment, celebrated in the Rocky Mountain News, okay, at the time and in all the annals of the history. And that's what resulted in the Plains region of Colorado being cleared of its Indian population.
Through. with you. They'll come for me in my bed. And after they're done having their fun, someone else will get it inside.